I was born in Philadelphia at Hahnemann Hospital at about 7 a.m. on a Sunday, March 8, 1942. My father went off to war about 6 months later. In World War II, he was gone for about 3 years. Grew up in an Irish Catholic neighborhood. I went to college and found out that it was a ghetto. I was highly offended. But then I realized that it was all Irish, it was all Catholic. And I think there was one Presbyterian church there. And it was a good upbringing. I joke now that I fell asleep listening to the Phillies on the radio. Now, modern, we fall asleep listening, watching the Phillies on TV. But I had a good education. The girls were always, I always placed third in school. You know, two girls were smarter. I graduated from St. Columbus. In eighth grade, I had this, oh, by the way, I had the same nun for sixth, seventh, and eighth grade. I hated, but she loved me very much, Sister Edward Francis, and got me through a few hard times in school. She and my mother would get together and parent teachers. Well, we don't want to get them a big head. Okay, we won't get them a big head. Anyway, graduated there and went to high school. The diocese changed. We were supposed to go to Roman Catholic High School, the oldest Catholic high school in the country, and but they had changed in population because they opened another school, and I wound up going to North Catholic and was exposed to the Oblates of St. Francis DeSales. And high school was a joy. Played football, managed the basketball team. I was always at school, and didn't get home until 7 o'clock at night. It was a great experience being a North Catholic. And then, you know, I thought about the vocation sometimes. I asked Father Joe Hughes, how do you know if you should be a priest? And he said, well, you don't know until you're 7 seconds after you're dead, if that's what you're supposed to do in life. Well, he was a big help. He seriously was a big help. Anyway, so I graduated from North Catholic on Friday night, and I went to work the next Monday at Tidewater Oil Company, known as Getty Oil now. And in the credit card section as a mailroom clerk. And then I got laid off. And the personnel guy said to me, you know, you should be in college. I said, I don't have no money for college. He said, you certainly can afford college. Save your money, go to state college. So I went and got a job for Philadelphia Warehousing and Cold Storage Company. My father didn't want me to work there. He worked there, you know, because they're lowlifes. Well, aren't we all? You know, he wanted something better for his son. Well, his son had a start at the bottom. I made enough money there, made good money there, as a laborer, unloading freight cars, and then eventually forklift driver. I remember the summer I had unload cocoa beans, 180-pound bags, sweating in a boxcar. My partner was a convicted murderer. The guy said to me, "Don't have an argument with that guy because he murdered somebody." But anyways, then I got enough money to go to college, and I went out and lived at Westchester State College for a year with a bunch of interesting guys. One of whom played football at Frankfurt, our arch enemy in high school, and another one, well, I have to tell this story. I scored a touchdown in South Philly because they changed the name of Bishop Neumann, South Catholic. They changed the name of South Catholic to Bishop Neumann because he was trying to make him a saint. And now he's St. John Neumann High School. And we were North Catholic, they were South Catholic. All Irish and Polish, and South Catholic was all Italian. And I scored a 60-yard touchdown, and I saw a penalty flag. And I figured that the penalty would be annulled and all that stuff. Well, it turns out it was this guy punching me in the end zone, and I wound up sharing a house with him in college. To this day, I figure St. John Neumann is getting even with me for beating them in football and for a bunch of other things, too. So when my second year at Westchester State, I drove a car. I decided to commute. I bought a car, and I had five girls in my carpool. It was like going to school, 45-minute drive, in the ladies' room. I'd pick up five of them, and they'd have me putting makeup on. I still remember seeing a leg up in the air in the rearview mirror for a pantyhose, and one girl, to remain unnamed, showed up in October all in her pajamas, all their clothes, their book bags. She got dressed in the back seat. So I went to college in the ladies' room every morning. And there were a bunch of good kids. But my life was going down the tubes, I thought, with a little too much partying and drinking. And I wanted to keep my life, be somebody, make a contribution. And so I wrote a letter to the vocation director of the Oblate of St. Francis DeSales. This is when I'm about 21 or 22. And I worked for a year or two, and then college for a year or two. And I inquired about, he said, y'all come on, no problem. My confessor said I should wait a year. So I figured I was not holy enough for them, but I was holy enough for the Oblates. And he said, yeah, bring your car and bring your golf clubs. When I showed up at the seminary with a car and a golf clubs, the scholastic master, the guy in charge, he said, oh, well, you got to get rid of those things. So my father got his first car, and I don't know whatever happened to the golf clubs because he didn't play golf. I was welcomed into the Oblates of St. Francis de Sales at Camp Brisson because they had decided that I was going to spend my postulant year teaching because they needed teachers, and I only had 2 years of college. But they did the things in those days, and I was sent to Bishop Duffy High School in Niagara Falls, New York. My first plane ride. I remember getting a little bit of air sick. We landed in Williamsport. Someplace else, and then Buffalo. An interesting tactic, how God works. I drove through Williamsville, Cheektowaga, Tonawanda, and Niagara Falls. And subsequently, I found out in reading the biography of St. John Neumann, he was a missionary in Niagara Falls. He was assigned to parish in Buffalo, but he built missions in Williamsville, Cheektowaga, and Tonawanda. And then Niagara Falls. So I figured he still didn't name with me for that football game. So I had a year teaching social studies and math, and I enjoyed it. It was a good year. It was a good year in the Oblate community. There were a lot of good men. The church was changing at the time. Kennedy was shot. Some of the guys left the priesthood and all that. It was a good year. And then they transferred me to the novitiate, which was a hell on wheels. I hated it. I decided to leave the seminary, and Father conned me the the provincial was doing this visit, and he said, I see now, that's how he talked. There's a pamphlet, that's how he said it. He had potatoes in his mouth. And so he said, there's a pamphlet by a priest named Greeley from Chicago. Well, I got the pamphlet and I read it and decided to stay. I owe my priestly vocation, if you will, to Andy Greeley. So I stuck it out in the novitiate. We learned to pray, sort of. And it was a cross. And then we took our first vows. And I still remember the phrases in Latin. And in plexu crucis tui, vovio ad anum pauper tatum castitatum obedientiam, secundum constitutione congregation obliges St. Francis de Sales. But I remember that phrase, at embracing your cross, at plexu crucis tui. And that's it's been a cross all along. All these people that say, oh yeah, the religious life is wonderful, beautiful, I've got to cherish my vocation. It's a cross, you carry a cross. Just like all the people that I came across carry their crosses. Big time carry crosses heavier than mine. So anyway, but we got through the novitiate. I was assigned to teach at Bishop Father Judge High School in Philadelphia. That was a good year, went by rather quickly. And then I got to finish college. I finished in a year because I took courses in the summer, two summers in 1 year. I even took 21 credits. And it was a great year. We went to a co-ed college, Niagara, because the Oblates got cheaper. Oblates were always practical. The tuition was cheaper. So they threw us in there. Had a wonderful year living at Chantel Hall, the seminar there. We mixed with the nuns a lot. And I remember almost killing the 30 nuns in a bus slipping down the icy road in Lewis to Hill, we called it. It was a very steep road. And we're coming back, driving the bus, bringing them back from Buffalo. So thanks be to God that the nuns didn't die. And how could they with a bus full of nuns? It was a great year at Lewiston, at Niagara Falls, Niagara. And truly, I remember it as one of the high points of my life. Anyway, then we went to the Theologate, the seminary in Washington, D.C., to DeSales Hall School of Theology. And it was miserable. It was a miserable 4 years. Yeah, we got by. It was hard work. At the beginning of my fourth year in Theologate, the seminary, they ordained us September 12th, 1970. And then we went back to school for the year. We primarily said Mass for convents. There were a lot of convents, house of studies in the Catholic University area. And we said Mass there. But in the process, the seminary was trying to get accredited by the American Association of Theological Schools, which was primarily a Protestant organization. So one of the criteria that Protestant seminaries had was, that we didn't have, was what they call pastoral field education. You had to go away out of the seminary for 6 credit hours. And I went in and talked to Father Nessel. I said, I'm volunteering 35 hours a week at Kennedy Institute for Retarded Children, built by Joseph Kennedy Foundation. And Ethel Kennedy was very, very responsive. Today we call them people, challenged individuals, or, but in those days they called them retarded. We wound up, we were part of the establishment of Special Olympics in D.C. with Sister Mary Murphy, a great crowd of nuns. And my classmate Dennis Mattern, we did soccer, we did basketball. The kids didn't know baseball too well because they couldn't get the sequence of second base to first base. But he said, "Well, we don't have formal agreement with Kennedy Institute, so pick something else." You know, and there was counseling homosexuals, counseling alcoholics, visiting Lorton Prison. I don't get nervous driving by outside Norton for Norton Prison. It's the prison for Washington, D.C. And so at the very bottom, it said military chaplains. So I figured I'd be a smart guy. And I'll say military chaplains. So he went in there and opened the phone book and said, well, there's Air Force, Army, and Navy. I call these numbers, the recruiting offices. The Air Force wasn't interested until you were ordained, but the Army and the Navy had student programs. So I called the Army and I called the Navy, and I had a choice that summer of spending the summer on Fort Hamilton, New York, outside of New York City, or Newport. Well, what would you pick? I don't want to be near a city. I picked Newport. So I wound up with a white uniform in the Navy, which is a great summer. The things that stand out from that summer is they threw me out of a helicopter on a cable, like that scared the living daylights out of me. And then we trained in that quite a bit. And then we had familiarization with weapons, which were kind of scary things at the range. So it was a good experience. I didn't think any more about it because you didn't think about going active duty in the Navy for about 10 years after you're ordained. That was just the way it was. So I finished that fourth year, and I got assigned to teach at North Catholic in Philadelphia. But in the meantime, the Navy called me and said, can you be free for the summer to go on a cruise to Europe? And I said, yeah, sure. So I asked permission and got a... And it turns out it was the Naval Academy training in the North Atlantic. We had two ships, the Shreveport and the Raleigh, and there were 300 mids in each ship, plus the ship's company. And a little tidbit there, I was on the Shreveport, and I'd go say mass on the Raleigh. And the Commodore asked me, Father, you ever referee basketball? I said, yeah, I refereed basketball for the retarded kids at Kennedy Institute. He said, well, the midshipmen and the ship's company, the crew, have been getting into fist fights at the basketball games. And can you get down to the well deck and referee? So I had a great time refereeing basketball for the crews. Visited several ports. Returned and took up my duties at North Catholic. I taught for a year. When the provincial, the same guy that was with me in the seminary recommended the Greeley book. He had my canonical visit with him, and he said, I'll see now. That's how he talked. I'll see now. Aren't you in the Navy Reserve? Yes. You think they'll take you full time? And I'm thinking to myself, God, there's a war on. Yeah, they'll take any warm body they can get. So I called Washington, and he said, can you show up next week? And I said, well, I should finish the school year and justice to the school. And so he gave me orders to Destroyer Squadron 11 in Pearl Harbor, Hawaii. I reported it on July 1st, and that began the Navy saga. It's amazing how God works, because I had never thought of military service, just being a priest. And I wound up in the Navy as a result of they needed a program in the seminary. So I signed up for the program. And then Father Conmee, after I was ordained a year and a half, wound up saying, ah, see now, aren't you in the Navy? You think they'll take you full time? So I wound up in the Navy, and first assignment was Destroyer Squadron 11. And we deployed to Vietnam for about 4 months. Well, we deployed earlier than that, 6 months, but 4 months were to the end of the war, or at least the ceasefire. But, you know, I was thinking one story I'd tell. There was on the USS Morton, and during general quarters, when I had nothing to do in general quarters, just sit there until a couple hours, and I wound up looking through the book, Register of Federal Occupations. It's a very thick telephone book size thing of every occupation in the United States, and I leafed through it, and I realized at the time I was thinking of leaving the priesthood, and I realized that there's nothing more worthwhile to do, and so I struck out on that one. So I finished my tour. with Desert 11, and I was transferred because they disbanded the squadron over to the 1st Marine Brigade at Kaneohe on the other side of the island. I spent a year there. And then the senior priest on the island knew I needed a chapel. I was working out of a suitcase and a mass kit, and had never had any chapel community. And I got orders because his buddy, a fellow Philadelphian named Tom Helferty, a Navy chaplain, who was assignment officer, which we call detailer, sent me to Yuma, Arizona, Marine Corps Air Station, Yuma, Arizona. And I drove across the country after visiting my sister. I got a new car, BMW, which I lasted for 14 years, and reported into MCAS. About 4 weeks later, I was determined to not go to dinner at anybody's house until I found out who God's uncle and God's aunt are, because God's uncle and God's aunt know how to run a parish, and they can't wait to tell the new pastor how to do that. So I was determined not to go to dinner, and about 4 weeks after I was there, Jim Watson asked me to dinner at their house Sunday afternoon. And I said, "Are you a Marine?" And he said, "No, I'm a civilian at YPG, Yuma Proving Grounds." And I said, "Well, okay." So it was my first encounter with the Watson family. Six kids were still at home. Jim and Mary had 9 kids. 3 were out to school, and they all sat around the table. And the bottom line is I found church there. They sat down for dinner, said grace before meals, and then after dinner, they would go around the table, and each child would say what they were thankful for or what they wanted to pray for. And then Jim would sum up the prayers and amen. He'd read a little scripture, very short, very, very Catholic, very short, and scripture verse. And I figured this is real church. This is how it's supposed to be. And then in the time in Yuma, they were all a bunch of religious people, and both Yuma and Mary, but Mary went to charismatic meetings. And so I would show up at these meetings, and I thought, frankly, I thought a lot of them were nuts. There was one lady that wanted to reordain me, lay hands on me and give me a special blessing and all that stuff. And I eventually was prayed over, but I only allowed men to do it, a police officer and 3 Marines. Well, I did have a mystical experience there. After being prayed over by those guys, I had clarity, incredible. Everything, every color was vivid, sounds were vivid. And it lasted about 48 hours, and then started to fade. But it was a tremendous experience that having that. And I recognize, while I didn't live it all the time, I recognize that it's there. There's a depth of spirituality. So, continuing on, then the guys asked me to, make a Curcio weekend. Oh, I hated that idea. Go to some weekend with a bunch of lay people, you know, and it was up in Phoenix. So I went up there and I did my duty as a priest then, because I know the catechism and all this stuff, and it was not really a hyper spiritual experience for me. But what I noticed was the men having a conversion experience, being brought closer to the Lord. The people would all sing, all visitors would show up early Sunday morning and sing it to the retreatants. And there's Jim and Mary and Bob Pratt and a bunch of other people from Yuma. They drove all the way to Phoenix to just sing 5 or 6 hymns. I was profoundly moved by that, and to the point where I feel like crying in gratitude now. And then after the Curcio experience, because I experienced church there, I experienced church in the charismatics, who were kind of goofy, and then it was much more realistic, the Curcio movement, a short course in Christianity. And then a doctor came to town and was going to Mass every day, and TAD to the air station, the surgeon. They needed an extra doctor. And he had just made a marriage encounter. Well, this point is, about 4 months later, I got a hernia. So Miguel Saldana, wonderful man, did the operation. And then he said to me, I'd like you to make a marriage encounter weekend yourself. I said, if I can go out of this hospital, I can go down to Yuma and not have to hire a substitute. He says, you don't understand. I can keep you in this hospital for 90 days, no questions asked. So I wound up making a marriage encounter weekend at the La Jolla Village Inn, and with steri strips on my wounds, and I wound up sitting on the floor with two or three pregnant women who also had to sit on the floor. So it was a great experience. And the charisma movement provided the mystical experience, and the Curcio movement provided a practical course in Christianity, and the marriage encounter encompassed it in flesh. They invited me to do weekends, and I did about 18 or 20 weekends as the priest and presiding, whatever you want to call it. So, but I found church in Yuma, not like anything in the seminary. The seminary is all doctrine and teaching and stuff like that. But this was people. This was real church that I experienced being part of. They taught me what church meant. And I've been eternally grateful. Little did I know that 30 years later, 25 years later, I'd return to Yuma and build three buildings. But I love Yuma. I love founding the faith. Yuma, Arizona made me a Catholic priest. One of the most prestigious and responsible assignments that a Navy chaplain can have is as the senior chaplain at the U.S. Naval Academy, and I was privileged to serve in that position for 4 years. Over 4,000 outstanding young men and women, intelligent, athletic, the majority striving for excellence. They brought me to life, made me feel young again with their youth and exuberance. It was indeed a 24/7 job. After my tour was over, the deputy commandant told me that the chaplains were the hardest working officers at the academy. I said, "You're kidding." He said, "No, I'm very serious. The chaplains had the pulse of the brigade and not only provided excellent pastoral care, but were most instrumental in maintaining a high level of morale in the brigade. It was a wonderful experience, and I thank God for the blessing of it." I was getting ready to retire from the Navy, and Monsignor O'Keefe, Ralph Soldano, Father Ralph Soldano, Father Wayne Weilander having lunch, and they decided that, hey, Friel is getting ready to retire. from the Navy, maybe he can come help out the Yuma Catholic High School initiative. So lo and behold, Sonny Rodriguez sent a letter to me, hoping to get a couple oblates at St. Francis de Sales. Well, he only got one, and I came to Yuma, and in March of 2000, March of 99, and proceeded to take part in the Yuma Catholic High School initiative. And by the 2000, August of 2000, we were ready to open it, raise money, all that kind of stuff. Did initial planning, architects and all that stuff. I'm the queen of ladies' rooms in Yuma, because in a meeting with the construction people, I noticed that there was only four stalls in the ladies' room. I said, there's room for about seven in here, maybe eight. Well, and they argue with me, but for 10 minutes, but it's all the code required, it's all we should put in there. I said, make believe I'm the owner, and I want seven at least in there. And in subsequent building projects, I also always maintain a preference for making sure that plenty of stalls in the ladies' rooms. Anyway, so we built Yuma Catholic High School. It was an amazing amount of tension, amazing amount of work. It was 24/7, and the best thing I did was hire Mike Glenn, Colonel Mike Glenn, Marine Corps helicopter pilot, Ronald Reagan's pilot in HMX-1. I hired him, asked him to come to Yuma from his retirement home. Elizabeth became an obedient wife, God love her, and Mike turned out to be the best influence in that school for about 10, 12 years. And beautiful man. Love Mike Glenn. Love him. So we finished the project, and I left Yuma Catholic at about in 2003. Went back for the first graduating class in 2004. And that was it. The bishop convinced me to take a parish at St. John Neumann in the foothills, a small burg. He said, you can run it out of your back pocket. So he never complained for 15 years because I ran it out of my back pocket. Unfortunately, I got out to the foothills, and they found out that they had a building program. What the heck? I didn't know about a building program. So, and we didn't have much money in it, so I wound up raising money and building a 21,000 square foot church, which I might say is one of the most beautiful churches in Arizona. And some of the priests have said that they, because I managed to get the used furniture, altar furnishings, a baldacchino from Lowell, Massachusetts. And long story, but how God works, everything is amazing how God works. I have no idea what I'm doing. Deacon Rick had no idea what he's doing. Shirley had some idea what she was doing, you know, but together the team built it, and all the help and all the people that donated. And we have a magnificent, as the bishop said, Cathedral of Yuma. In addition to that, Deacon Rick says there was some sale on steel. A guy went bankrupt, but he was trying to build a church up there in Lakes Havasu. So the steel was already manufactured. So we got a steel on the steel, and we bought the steel and put it in the backyard for a couple of years until we figure out the financing. And then we wound up building a 20,000 square foot hall, parish hall, which embarrassingly, they managed the name after me.
Make me a channel of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me bring your love. Where there is injury, your pardon, Lord. And where there's doubt, true faith in you.
Up, what a gift my life has been, and all the twists and turns. Accidentally wound up in the Navy because of that. They needed a program in the seminary, and I wound up in the Navy. Flip of a coin, pretty much so in the Navy rather than the Army, because I didn't want to be in New York. I wanted to be in Newport, Rhode Island, and then a relatively safe area of Vietnam, and two tours that I dream about immensely. The USS Midway, which was 24/7, absolutely. By the way, commercial, if you haven't toured the USS Midway Museum in San Diego, and it's the fifth most popular museum in the country, so go to the Midway and see where John Friel slept here. And I want to put a sign on my room, but they won't let me do that. So, but how God works in our lives. You know, I am totally grateful, especially the last probably official thing I did was lead that pilgrimage to the Holy Land with 40 people. And when a trip came over, I put my head on the pillow that night. My heart was bursting with gratitude that I could lead those people to the dream trip of their life. You know, but when I look at it all of the experiences of building a Yuma Catholic, and little did I know my life would turn out this way. I got out of the Navy, and when I became Bob the Builder, you all know that song, right? Bob the Builder, yes, I can. I didn't know that I would become Bob the Builder with the high school, the parish church, and the parish hall, and then the building the columbarium, which has gone over real big. People are like the idea of being buried on church ground. And so I'm grateful for my life. All I can say is beat Army.
Lost and alone on some forgotten highway, traveled by many, remembered by few. Looking for something that I can believe in. Looking for something that I'd like to do with my life. There's nothing behind me and nothing that ties me to something that might have been true yesterday. Tomorrow is open Right now it seems to be more than enough to just be here today. And I don't know what the future is holding in store. I don't know where I'm going. I'm not sure where I've been. There's a spirit that guides me, a light that shines for me. My life is worth living. I don't need to see the end. Sweet, sweet surrender.
All I can say is, Pete Army.